A bizarre kidnapping on Cleveland's west side tonight. The recall effort against Dennis Kucinich reaches the 11th hour again.
Fred has highlights on the tribe's latest win, and Mike outlines some nice weather and some pollution.
News Center 8 is next with those stories and a live city cam report from Bill McKay. Runways race with the rain at Hopkins Airport.
Polaroid's one step. You never focus. A motor hands you the picture. And look at the new SX70 film. Brighter color, and you'll see it twice as fast as before.
Who took that?
Me.
Polaroid's one step. Simplest camera in the world.
We're making two cups of tea, using two bags of another leading tea to one Tetley tea bag. You might expect the other brand to become twice as dark as Tetley, but after 4 minutes, the difference is far less than you might have thought. One Tetley tea bag brews tea just about as deep and dark as the other two tea bags. So if you prefer a darker tea, Tetley is the one.
I like those tiny little tea leaves in Tetley tea.
Oh, I forgot to get the vacation money.
What? And my bank's closed.
Oh, I forgot to transfer money from my savings and my bank's closed.
Well, I wish I could borrow some extra money, but my bank's closed.
Central Ready Banks are always open when you need them, 24 hours a day, and they can do just about anything a bank can do.
This guy sent me $25 cash. I said, I don't have that much cash. He said, you got a Ready Bank card? I said, oh, yeah, take me to Ready Bank.
WJKW TVA Cleveland.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jim Finnerty. Here's what's happening. A bizarre kidnapping story on the west side of Cleveland tonight. It happened near West 47th and State, where John Kleckner had gone to do some work at the Jehovah Witness Kingdom Hall. Kleckner had left his 90-year-old mother in the car, the keys in the ignition. When he looked up, the car and Amelia Kleckner were gone.
Well, mother's got gray hair. She's approaching 90, and her apparel she had on was a yellow sweater and a flowered nightgown with brown overshoes. And
What about the car now?
The car itself is a 64 Chrysler, light blue, and it's a New Yorker.
So far, there's been no word on the whereabouts of the car or Amelia Kleckner. If you have any information, contact police in the 2nd District at 623-5200. A dramatic hit-skip accident at East 40th and Chester this afternoon, as three women, one of whom had just been released from a hospital, were struck as their car went through an intersection. 44-year-old Arlene Hartridge of Brecksville was taken to Charity Hospital, along with 47-year-old Maureen O'Neill and 40-year-old Marlene Nescola. Police say their car was struck on the left side by another car, which then left the scene. Cleveland Auxiliary Policeman Bill Hartman was there, too. He witnessed the accident and gave chase.
I called him around the corner on 36th Street. I asked him for his driver's license. He told me to get away from him, you know. I showed him my badge that I'm a Cleveland Auxiliary Policeman. And he said, well, okay.
Did he take off again or what?
And I told him to pull the car in the parking lot and park it and leave it and ride the bus home or something, you know. And he says that he wasn't going to do nothing like that. And he jumped back in the car and took off again. And when he got around here, I took the keys out of the ignition so he couldn't go nowhere then.
Police have taken that driver into custody tonight, along with a small revolver reportedly being carried by the man. That's not the only accident which figures in this weekend's news. Kathy has that. Kathy?
At least 92 persons have lost their lives on the nation's highways since the holiday weekend began 24 hours ago. Five have died on Ohio state roads alone. The National Safety Council estimates that 500 motorists will be killed in traffic accidents by midnight Monday, so police are cracking down on speeders who ignore the 55-mile-an-hour limit. The crackdown is being termed Operation CARE by the state police across this nation. Transportation officials say the campaign is the most effective way to reduce holiday traffic fatalities. If you must take to the highway this Memorial weekend, News Center 8 advises that you please drive carefully. The life you save may be your own.
Kathy, a lot of people weren't driving today, choosing instead to stand in long lines for their 1978 license tags. If your last name begins with the letters L through Z, you have until next Thursday to pick up your new validation sticker. Today, a lot of people waited and wondered why they didn't do it earlier.
They should leave these things open from 12 in the afternoon until 8 at night, and then people would have more time to do what had to be done sooner or later.
Why'd you wait so long?
Well, it's working, no babysitter, husband's in school. Just takes time to get down here.
Well, I'm coming just for license plates. I just got a new car.
Oh, just got a new car.
Right. If I would have known this, I would have got it sooner.
And a reminder, if your tags aren't on by Thursday, you could be in for a ticket and a long wait in line until you can drive again.
A plane crash overnight has taken the life of a Virginia man and injured two Cleveland residents. The twin-engine plane reportedly developed engine trouble while in flight to Dulles Airport when it nosedived into a lake in Bumpus, Virginia. Dead is 36-year-old John Campbell of Virginia, whose body is still in the wreckage under 40 feet of water. The two Cleveland men, 40-year-old Henry Meyer Jr. and 51-year-old Frank Starbrook, were treated at a nearby hospital for head and chest injuries.
Clevelanders traveling by plane from Hopkins Airport will notice a change in the next 2 weeks when the field's longest runway reopens after major renovation work. News Center 8's Bill McKay Hopkins Airport tonight and says that travelers won't be the only ones who are happy about that change. Bill?
Tim, how right you are. As a matter of fact, taking off now, just behind us, I think it's a 727, 737 on its way over Fairview Park. And the residents of Fairview, people like Rocky River, places I should say like Rocky River and Fairview and Berean, they have been going through some inconvenience because of the 2 months of renovation work that's going on out here at Hopkins International Airport. John? We understand that we're down to 0 hour, and pretty soon all that inconvenience is going to be over. How much longer? What has to be done?
We're right on schedule now. We should definitely be open no later than the midnight of the 7th of June. We have to finish the painting, the lines, markers, center lines, different markings on there, and then the grooving. The grooving should start Wednesday or Thursday, take approximately 6 days, and it will be a 24-hour operation. And we should be done by June 7th at midnight and ready to go 1 minute after midnight.
John, I thank you very much. So there you have it, Jim. Another 7, maybe 8 more days of inconvenience. Then the runway will be open and all that noise will be gone for the most part again. John, thank you for being with me. I'm Bill McKay. We are live with the CityCam at Cleveland Hopkins International Airport.
And when we come back, a report on the final days of the recall drive. Jim will have that. As for the USS Cod, things are just beginning. Those stories and more when News Center 8 continues.
Bird is growing. Now Thunderbird's custom touches and distinctive look are reflected in Baby Bird, the new Fairmont Futura with dynamic styling. Futura is priced $700 less than Monte Carlo or Cutlass Supreme and beats both in mileage with 7 miles per gallon more. There's a little bit of Bird in every Futura. Buy one today and get immediate delivery. See your Ford dealer.
Do you know the smart way to get your car repaired? First, get a written estimate. Make sure the mechanic is qualified. And be certain all repairs are backed in writing.
Can you get all this in one place?
Yes.
At your Shell Auto Care dealers. Look for this sign. Come to Shell Auto Care dealers for answers.
Union Commerce Bank delivers the easy way to pay your bills. Union Commerce Pay by Phone. For details, call 771-1212.
Now, the taste of High C in a powder. New High C drink mix.
High C, you know how good it is.
The 11th hour is drawing near for efforts to recall Cleveland Mayor Dennis Kucinich. Leaders of the recall campaign joined workers in the street today and say they expect to have at least twice the number of signatures needed when they hand in their petitions tomorrow night. Recall workers turned in 47,000 signatures a month ago, but 3,300 short of the required amount were finally validated. Since then, they say they've collected over 7,000 signatures in the
effort. Moving right along, probably by the end of July, there could be a recall election unless some stopped by the courts or by the Kucinich camp.
What if you come up short again this time?
That's it. We're out of it then. If we come up short, which we won't, we're out of it. But we're very confident at this point.
News Center 8's Bill McKay also learned today that gathering those signatures hasn't always been easy.
When I covered the market at West 25th, I actually had people grab me. Could get away from them.
What would they say to you?
Anything and everything. Like I said, yeah. Communist, you're destroying our country, what are you doing?
Could you identify any of these people at all?
No. Some of them well-dressed, some of them not.
Cleveland City Council Clerk Mercedes Cotner will have to validate these signatures. They will be given to her tomorrow night. Kathy?
It was the public support that saved the USS Cod, Cleveland's own submarine. And because of that noble effort, it's on display at the East 9th Street Pier. Well, today, the decks of the World War II sub were open to the public for the summer season, and by way of bagpipes leading it. The floating monument has numerous improvements this year. The deck gun is one addition with a museum as well. Visitors who plan to tour the Cod, listen up. It's located on North Marginal Drive at East 9th Street and is open to the public from 1 to 5 on weekends and 11 to 4 p.m. Monday through Wednesday.
That's a great tour if you've never been inside a submarine. Interesting. A couple of names on the sick list tonight. One of them is entertainer Jackie Gleason. He was admitted to a Chicago hospital this morning complaining of chest pains. He's reported tonight in fair condition. And comedian Jimmy Durante is reported in fair condition also. Durante is in a California hospital where he's undergoing treatment for a respiratory infection.
And the air you're breathing is hazardous to your health and will remain dangerous through tonight. Jim will have a report on that. Weather and sports right after this.
I live in New Hampshire, but I love New York.
I live in North Carolina, but I love New York.
Call toll-free for our free 100-page vacation guide. It's filled with affordable vacation packages and ideas. Find out why outdoor lovers from the Carolinas to Canada love New York.
I live in Brooklyn, but I love New York.
Your bathroom bowl is subject to a lot of different stains and germs. Super Strength Snow Bowl removes even the toughest stains, like rust, in seconds. Snow Bowl does it faster and easier than both the leading liquid and dry bowl cleaners. See? Stains gone. And as it cleans, Snow Bowl also disinfects and deodorizes. Super Strength Snow Bowl. It cleans even the toughest stains in seconds.
It's a great feeling, the feeling of pride. The pride that comes from putting forth your very best and having it judged the very best. The people who make Wishbone Italian know that pride. It comes from giving you only our very best, blending choice herbs and spices for flavors so perfect. Wishbone Italian is America's favorite Italian salad dressing. For Wishbone, only the best is good enough.
Century 21. We sell all kinds of houses for all kinds of people.
Since nature is our best teacher, students at Case Western Reserve have taken to the outdoors to study biology. News Center 8's Gary Stromberg, who studied the students for this report, picks up the story.
At first glance, it looks like this young man is spending a quiet afternoon fishing out on the lake. But in reality, he's hard at work on a biology research project. The biology majors at Case Western Reserve have a unique facility where they can conduct their experiments. It's a biology farm or field experiment station located on a sprawling country estate in Hunting Valley, just 10 miles from campus. Students can come here and get involved in all sorts of experiments. Some are studying the tolerance of rainbow trout to varying environments. Others are studying the breeding habits of fish, things that cannot be studied in traditional classrooms.
Well, I think the major advantage is that in a major urban area, you have a situation here in which the students can actually, not going too far from the major campus, get out into habitats in which you can actually carry out serious ecological research.
One student is involved in studying the eating habits of bumblebees. Others are looking into the density of insects in a grassy clump. All of these things may seem unnecessary to some observers, but these young biologists may come up with vital information about how to protect animals from ecological danger or learn how to develop new sources of food. The Case Western Reserve Biology Farm doesn't produce crops, but hopefully its students will produce a good harvest of information. Gary Stromberg, News Center 8.
And maybe something to beat the mosquitoes as well. Speaking of beating, the tribe. Yes. Victorious this afternoon.
Yeah, we had four surplus runs today. I mean, nice if you could put them in the bank and then save them for tomorrow, right? In case you need a run, we'll just take one from yesterday.
That'd be great.
Doesn't quite work that way.
Got highlights?
We sure do in a minute.
Dear Joey, getting my hair done. Be back at 3:30. Please go to Lawson's and pick up bread, lunch meat, potato salad, and pop. And if you want, something to hold you over till dinner time. Thanks for helping me, Joey. Love, Mom. P.S. Later we'll go out for a treat.
Joey, I'm home.
There's always something special at Lawson's, so come on in.
Lifting all that weight makes me feel just great. Now's the time I find, got Blue Ribbon on my mind.
I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind. More and more lately I find I've got a taste for living. I'm thinking cold Blue Ribbon. I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
Naturally good Pabst, a lot to look forward to.
Hey, Spidey, isn't Marvel's new Pizzazz magazine fantastic?
Fantastic, but not perfect.
But Pizzazz has the lowdown on Jaws, too, and more Sean Cassidy picks than his mother. It's sensational.
Sensational, but not perfect.
How about Pizzazz's Goofy Guide to TV? It's wild look at sci-fi movies. It's games, puzzles, comics. What could be more perfect?
Me on the cover. Not the Hulk.
Pizzazz, the almost perfect new monthly from the off-the-wall gang at Marvel Comics.
You know, there's nothing like six runs coupled with a solid pitching performance to end a three-game losing streak. The Indians got both this afternoon in a 6-1, 6-2 victory over Baltimore. The offense came against a pretty fair pitcher in Mike Flanagan. This double in the third by Buddy Bell chased home Tom Verizer, who had singled. Following a walk to Mike Vail, Willie Horton dumped one to center, scoring Rick Manning, who had singled. Bell also crossed the plate. It was 3-0. Then in the fourth, Bell collected the second of his three base hits on the afternoon. It brought Cox around easily, and it was a 4-0 contest, and things were looking pretty sweet. Then Johnny Grubb finished the Indian parade with his fifth home run of the campaign. It came with a man aboard in the fifth inning. David Clyde, by the way, was superb for the third time in a row. He scattered seven hits and going the route for the second time in three starts. He only walked two and is now 3-0. Tomorrow, a doubleheader. You'll be able to see the nightcap following the NBA playoff game right here on TV8. Another baseball activity this afternoon, Boston in a pitcher's duel over Detroit. Luis Tiant tossed a seven-hitter. Jim Rice hit his 17th homer. Rick Bossetti drove in three runs as Toronto surprised the Yankees 4-1. Oakland beat the Chicago White Sox with a run in the 10th on Jim Essien's single. Kansas City and Minnesota were washed out. In the National League, one game to report, L.A. leading San Fran in the 7th inning. Last night, by the way, the Giants beat the Dodgers in front of better than 45,000 at Candlestick. Well, three area high school baseball squads are headed for Columbus and a crack at a state crown. At Euclid, the host Panthers eliminated Bay 2-0 in a storybook pitcher's duel. Rick Wiltrout, right here, struck out 8. He gave up one hit. Rick Nauman also gave up one hit in a losing effort for Bay. Nauman fanned 9. The Panthers hand the left-hander his first defeat with a run in the second inning following a walk, a pass ball, and a sacrifice bunt. And Carl Punjerchar came home on this wild pitch. A Jerry Dropnik double brought home the other run. Bay bows out at 29-2. Another regional play today, it was Austin Town Fitch defeating Canton Glen Oak by the score of 4-1. In the AA regional play, it was Benedictine over Uniontown Lake, 4-1. Norwalk over Coshocton by the score of 9-1. In the Class A regional play, Ashtabula St. John's pounds Richmond Heights by the score of 13-2. It's been a pretty productive day for area high schools in the state track meet in Columbus. They're still going in Class AAA boys and girls, but Warrensville Heights is the AA king tonight for the boys. The Tigers captured one event today, the 880-yard relay. The winners collected 44 points for an 8-point margin of victory. Elyria West took third, just in front of Elyria Catholic and Benedictine. On the girls' side, Avon was the best finisher. They tied for second. In Class A, the boys' team championship went to Lorraine Clearview today by 4 points. Ashtabula St. John was seventh. Well, Bob Murphy has taken over the lead of the Atlanta Golf Classic after three rounds. A 67 today leaves him at 15 under, one shot better than Jerry Hurd, and two up on Tom Watson. Yesterday's leader, Dave Eichelberger, slumped to a 77. He's now seven shots back. Well, it'll be Bjorn Borg and Adriano Panatta in the finals of the Italian Open tomorrow. Borg eliminated the last American hopeful, Eddie Dibbs, in today's semifinals, 6-4, 6-3, 6-love. Panatta received an assist from a hostile crowd today in his hometown in a match with Spain's Jose Higueras. When the Italian dropped the opening set 6-love, the crowd began heckling Higueras unmercifully, ignoring the pleas from the umpire to stop. After losing the second set 5-7, Higueras stormed off the court. Well, there's been no competing with the racket this weekend at Randall Park Mall. Three-time Wimbledon U.S. Open champion Fred Perry is conducting a three-day free tennis clinic with former touring pro Jack March. As you might expect, prospective students have been of all shapes, ages, and sizes. Fred agrees tennis is still enjoying a boom in this country. He says especially among middle-aged women.
It's a wonderful thing. They get the husband off to work in the morning, get the kids off to school, jump in the car, go to the supermarket, buy the things for the day, go back and play tennis. I think it's marvelous. I think it's great. Now, all of a sudden, they're trying to do something with an arm that's 27 inches longer than it always has been. So they have to get used to that first. So my first advice would be, by the use of the mirror, everybody's got a big mirror at home, to get an idea of what it feels like and a mental picture of what it looks like, even if they swing wrongly.
And Jim, speaking of girls, Mid-Park in the state softball regionals defeated Cuyahoga Falls today 4-2, so they go to Columbus.
Very good. Okay, thanks, Fred. Ecologically, the greater Cleveland area remains in pretty poor shape tonight. We continue under an air pollution alert, which went into effect yesterday when the pollution level for Cuyahoga County reached 210. At last report this afternoon, the level had dropped to 157, but that's expected to change tonight and go above 200 again. People with respiratory and cardiovascular diseases should limit their outdoor activities, and all incinerators, all, are restricted to use only from noon until 4 p.m. until the alert is lifted. Dirty air.
Yeah, well, the weather was bad, but, I mean, the pollution was bad, but the weather was nice.
Simply
can't complain
delightful.
About that.
No, and it looks like that stale air is going to stay with us for a while, too, because high pressure just camped right on top of the state. It's going to keep our skies clear and a lot of sunshine with us, but the bad air is going to remain. We'll tell you the whole story when we come back.
No matter what sign of the zodiac you are, you could win up to $10,000 instantly, and maybe even $1,000 a week for life with Lucky Stars, the new Ohio Instant Lottery. Just rub, match three amounts, and win that amount instantly up to $10,000. Non-winners can enter the new TV jackpot with over $100,000 in prizes each week. Hello, Leo.
So no matter what sign you are, catch your Lucky Stars!
The new Ohio Instant Lottery.
Bill Green had the dull lunch blues, and so did Bill Jr. Until Mrs. Green discovered Smokehouse Almonds in handy foil packs, the almonds with a fantastic flavor. Now the lunch brigade at work, and the lunch bunch at school can't wait for lunch. One nibble is never enough, so put in two packs. Blue Diamond Smokehouse Almonds, the snack you know makes good sense.
The good times are worth saving,
And right now, Bank Ohio can help save those memories while you're saving money with Pleaser, Kodak's exciting instant camera. Only $15.95 plus tax with qualifying deposit or loan. Just aim, shoot, and crank out beautiful sharp color pictures that develop before your eyes in minutes. Save money, save memories with the Kodak Pleaser camera. Only $15.95 plus tax with qualifying deposit or loan at your nearby Bank Ohio office. The memories will last forever, but this offer won't.
Well, a delightful day for all kinds of outdoor activities today, and many people were out and about. Let's take a look now and see what the current conditions look like at, at Hopkins Airport. 82 degrees. Relative humidity is very low at only 33%. The barometer is steady at 30.14. The winds are northerly at 7 miles an hour. No precipitation today. The pollution index figure went up to 200 today. The outlook for tomorrow, again, 200. And, of course, that is at the alert level. A quick look at National Weather Service TV8 color radar shows us no precipitation anywhere in sight. A high today of 84 after a morning low of 55 a year ago, a bit cooler at 78 and 47. Lake Erie temperature remains 53 degrees. And within the past hour, these are the temperatures that have been recorded. 87 degrees in evidence down along the Ohio River and as far north as Columbus. But the hot news today in Ohio is Akron-Canton. They set a record of 92 degrees today. Within the hour, it was still 91, so it's a bit warm in Akron-Canton today. Sunrise tomorrow morning at 5:58. The sun will set tomorrow evening at 8:51. A look at the satellite picture now. This picture taken at 1 this afternoon shows a great deal of clear skies and sunshine in Ohio. Some cloudiness out in the midsection of the country, and that is associated with the weather system that we find anchored with a storm cell here in eastern Colorado. It goes down as a stationary front into Old Mexico, continues as a stationary front right up to the Wisconsin-Minnesota border, and then as a cold front on up to James Bay. It is kicking off some thundershower activity up in this part of the country, down into Iowa, and also down into Texas, the Oklahoma area, and also into Kansas as well. This is a very slow-moving front. It's stationary, most of it. Even the section of it that is a cold front is very slow-moving. High pressure over us is going to keep it from moving our way. Let's turn to the forecast now. Winds on the lake tonight will be variable on into tomorrow at about 10 miles an hour. For tonight, clear and mild, the overnight low 60 degrees. For tomorrow, again, clear and mild with a high in the mid-80s. Looking ahead to Monday, sunny skies, but later in the day, a chance of thundershowers late Monday evening. And Tuesday and Wednesday looking fair. Highs all during the week, 85 degrees, somewhere in the mid-80s. Thursday's outlook, we'll call it partly cloudy, but very warm temperatures, Kathy.
I think summer is finally here, thank goodness. Time now for some comments from our viewers on editorial feedback. Here with that is TV8's Community Affairs Director, Sandra Johnson. This week's mailbag contained the following letters. Ms. J.L. of Cleveland writes, "The desegregation coverage currently being presented to the public is an insult to black people everywhere. What it is really saying is, unless you go to school with another race, you won't receive an education. To do this, you get on a bus. Let's quit spending big tax dollars on a deputy, master, monitors, and what have you, and get quality education in neighborhood schools. I went to school to learn, not to be aware of who was seated around me." On another topic, Mr. M.O. of Cleveland comments, "I see that Blue Cross of Northeast Ohio and Blue Shield will be erecting a 20-story tower building in the near future. They raised my premium rate 5 times, giving the people a lot of bull about being almost broke. Subscribers are getting fed up with the rates, and yet we need the insurance. Where does this end? Another gripe I have is raising the postal rates. Do they need a new building also?" Excerpts from recent letters to TV8. We'd like to hear from you.
Revco summertime savings are as great as all outdoors.
You need all the Revco you can get.
Discount prices that'll never fail you when you need picnic paraphernalia. Peachy beach things, oceans of suntan lotions, bug killers, barbecue grillers, lazy chaise lounges, and patio chairs. Everything's there for fun-filled, sun-filled, happy times. All discount priced at Revco.
You need all the Revco you can get.
Caesar for Cristabella.
Buongiorno. Ma cosa bella Cristabella? Ma non dice la vina na cocktail.
He says in Italy we have something like your happy hour, except we have many of them before meals, during meals, or after meals. And we drink at cocktail times a wine like Cristabella, the medium dry white wine, which tastes perfect before, during, or after anything.
I say all that?
Cristabella, for all your happy hours.
Special offer from Kenny King's. Colorful 16-ounce Ziggy glasses to take home when you order sugar-free 7-Up at our special price. Collect a set only at Kenny King's.
Air Canada makes it easier to fly to Canada with super budget fares that can save you up to 40%. So next time, take the easy way up.
Think you have troubles? Bonnie DeRobertis of Los Angeles has filed suit against the Rolls-Royce agency there because it took them 9 months to repair her Rolls. What's more, the bill ran $6,000 over the repair cost, totaling $8,426. And for that amount, you can purchase an American-made car.
Don't worry about the mileage. That's our time for now on News Center 8. We'll see you tonight at 11. Have a good evening.
Good reason to buy.
For a sandwich treat made oatmeal, corn flour, and crushed wheat, and wheat bran, and molasses, and honey. You get Granny's old-fashioned bread for your money. Shortening soya, sugar, and yeast. Hillbilly makes a sandwich a feast. Nourishing, too, that's what I said. Hillbilly old-fashioned bread. I say hillbilly, hillbilly, hillbilly old-fashioned bread. It's colossal.
Look how easy it is to save money with American Airlines Superfares.
Save 40% round trip to anywhere we fly in the continental United States. Or save up to 50% on round trip night coach flights. Up to 50% off with American Airlines Superfares.
We're American Airlines, doing what we do best.
And helping you save money is one of the things we do best.
It's a great feeling, the feeling of pride, the pride that comes from putting forth your very best and having it judged the very best. The people who make Wishbone Italian know that pride. It comes from giving you only our very best, blending choice herbs and spices for flavors so perfect. Wishbone Italian is America's favorite Italian salad dressing. For Wishbone, only the best is good enough.
WJKW TV 8 Cleveland.
From TV 8 in Cleveland, this is Public Square with Mike Keene. Joining Mike tonight, along with our studio audience, are James L. Freeman, psychologist Dr. Savine Wiseman, and medical oncologist Dr. Carl Grabe.
Hello, everybody. Coping with cancer. I think that statement says it all about tonight's show. We are dealing with the psychological effects of cancer, effects often as difficult and terrifying as the disease itself. And each of our guests is qualified to discuss the topic. One is more than qualified. He is James L. Freeman. He's the Stark County Clerk of Courts, and he's a man who has literally stared death in the face. Mr. Freeman, at the age of 28, has licked a massive cancer attack. 5 years ago, he was given little hope by some doctors, little hope that he would live, and today he plans to write a book titled Don't You Ever Give Up, and they're words to live by for him. Joining Mr. Freeman are psychologist Dr. Savine Wiseman, who specializes in the treatment of the seriously ill, very seriously ill, and Dr. Carl Grappi of the Cleveland Clinic. And Dr. Grappi is, I think I can pronounce it right, an oncologist. Is that fair?
Very okay. Close.
And that, if you don't know, is the branch of medicine dealing with tumors. I will start the questions here, and a bit later in the program, we will field questions from the studio audience. I have one thing written down that I didn't want to forget. and it was to be directed to you, Jim Freeman. What went through your mind originally when the doctors gave you the score? They said, this is the way it is. This is the kind of shape you're in. What was your immediate reaction to that?
My first reaction was probably shock, and that lasted probably about 10 minutes. And after that, I decided that what the doctor had told me wasn't going to happen because I didn't believe I was going to die, and if there was anything I could possibly do to stay alive, I would do it.
That says a lot about you and your personality. It says that you're a pretty strong guy and a pretty positive guy.
I suppose I am, yeah.
I wonder how much depends, Dr. Wiseman, on one's personality when dealing with dread diseases like cancer.
Everything depends on the personality and the way in which persons confront a crisis. However, there are some things that most people experience. There are some generalities. Mm-hmm. And of course, when we make a generalization, there are always some people that it won't apply to, and I think Mr. Freeman is one. It seems as if you went through what we call the stages of grieving, whether that's in anticipation of death or in fear of death or for the survivors after. You went through those stages very fast. 10 minutes, you're saying. Because, of course, shock and disbelief are usually the first feelings, you know, that come forth. And for most people, that lasts a while.
Well, I said,
they don't get into fighting quite so soon as you
said earlier. He looks pretty good to me. And in fact, I was talking about the fact I had a bout with the flu, and he looks better than I do. And you do look terrific. And you're very, I don't know, healthy looking. And you are healthy at this point. Dr. Grappi, when a serious cancer case crops up and there are physicians such as yourself involved and you meet, are there various treatments recommended? Who decides finally on what treatment would be appropriate?
Well, somebody has to be the quarterback, and you rely upon your colleagues, in other specialties, surgery, radiotherapy, and then somebody decides, well, this is a play that we're going to make. Mm-hmm. And who that person is who conveys that message probably varies from situation to situation, depending upon who establishes the contact.
Are sometimes treatments tried and they are not as successful as they might be, and then they go back to the drawing board and say, hey, we better try something else? Does that happen a great deal of the time, or do you usually stick with one treatment when it's prescribed?
No, you have to be flexible, and what is important today, you may come right around and change it tomorrow, because unless you are that way, your success rate will not be as great. You've got to be alert to new developments as far as the patient is concerned, new developments maybe in effectiveness of treatment, and change the game plan halfway through. Hmm.
Jim, maybe you're the wrong guy to ask this because you're such a positive fella. I was going to ask you, does the fear end for a cancer patient? All right, you've been pronounced cured. They say, okay, you're all right. Does that feeling, I won't say fear, I'll say, does the feeling remain? Hey, I might get it again. I might have to go through this again.
Occasionally, that does cross my mind. It is a possibility with anybody who did have cancer that it can be a recurring disease, yes.
So you do think about it, but you don't
occasionally, not
preoccupy yourself with it.
Yes.
Dr. Wiseman, oftentimes relatives and friends are more affected than the patient in diseases like cancer. How do you deal with the people that are close to the cancer victim or the patient?
I really try to get the family and the person who has cancer to talk together about it and to be honest and open in talking about their feelings of sadness and disappointment and anger, and what will they do if the person does die. You pay a high cost, there's a high cost for pretending. Mm-hmm. And pretending is also very depressing. You can only keep up a pretense for so long, and then it really gets to you. And so it's as if it clears the air, or it makes people closer together when they can really talk about it, cry together, and then plan together, plan how they're going to fight it together.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Grappi, We hear a lot about progress being made in cancer cure or in control of cancer. We also hear that there are a lot of divisive elements. The AMA, the Cancer Society, you know, various people involved. Are too many cooks spoiling the broth, or are we all united in this effort, and are we going forward? Do you see it that way, that we are united and together, or are there too many people going in too many directions?
I think that because cancer involves not only treatment, diagnosis, it involves prevention, and because of the many facets, you need this many cooks. And if we're going to make progress, everybody has to become involved. Mm-hmm. We've got to learn to prevent cancer. We've got to learn to detect it early. We've got to spread the message concerning treatment of cancer.
What I think I wanted to say, is there a concerted effort, or are people going off in their own quests?
Well, I think basically there is a concerted effort. Sometimes the wild schemes may get undue publicity, but I think there is a organized approach to doing something constructive about cancer.
Well, we have a lot of ground to cover here, and we have a large audience, and they're anxious to ask questions, so we're going to break away for a commercial. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Well, it may look easy, but boy, I'm telling you, to get ready for the biggest skull race of the year, Henley, takes workout after workout after workout. You know, just looking at those guys makes me thirsty. Makes me wish I could turn them on to that beer I really used to enjoy back at Colgate. Genesee.
Our one brewery makes it best. Genesee.
She used to be my girl.
Get ready.
She used to be my girl.
Get ready for a big, explosive surprise from the OJs. Their new album, So Full of Love, is so full of sensational songs like Used to Be My Girl, their newest big hit single, The OJs.
All right, the audience is anxious and we have to move along, so we will get started. Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Freeman, what do you tell cancer patients when you visit them in the hospital?
Well, it all depends what's the matter with them. If they aren't having the proper treatments that I feel would be necessary to save them, or if their doctor's more or less just running tests and stuff and it looks like the guy's kind of bad, I try to get him to motivate himself to perhaps talk to another doctor or perhaps go up to Roswell Park and let them take a look at him.
I wonder, does that make the doctors mad? Do they feel that you're interfering?
Sure does.
You're a troublemaker, in other words.
In some cases, yes.
Dr. Weissman, how often do you meet families where they are protective and don't want the patient to know that they have cancer, and how do you deal with that?
I never force anyone to talk about anything. You can't really do that. But I encourage people to talk together. I think that if the person with cancer or if the family is not ready to talk openly about it, there's not much you can do except encourage them, try to convince them that it will be better in the long run, even though it's very difficult.
We were chatting a moment ago about the effect that cancer has on people that hire in jobs, and you wanted to say something about that, so this is the time to do it.
People find a lot of social discrimination and job discrimination when they have cancer.
It's a stigma.
Yes, it's like, it's catchy. And if you associate with a person, you might catch it. And it also represents the possibility of death, and people try to avoid that. And so it really changes one's social relationships. But talking openly about it, as you must have done, helps other people too. You know, don't be afraid of me. And then there's a lot of job discrimination. People sometimes lose time from their work because of the treatments, because they don't feel well, or surgery, or they have difficulty getting a new job if an employer feels that finds out that the person has cancer, they won't hire them. And so many people are forced to lie. And it's interesting that they can lie and no one suspects they have cancer, but if they tell the truth, they won't be hired. It's just irrational and very unfair.
I actually have a dual question, one for Mr. Freeman. There was no mention if you were involved in counseling or if your family was during this whole ordeal, this trauma. If so, what was the support rendered? And also for the other panel, what could we as a community, I'm a clinical social worker, could we develop to better meet the needs of our cancer patients in the area of emotional support?
All right, how about Jim fielding this one and the doctor fielding it?
The only counseling I had was, I was fortunate enough that with the doctors that I had, that any time I asked them a question, they realized that I was mature enough that they could give me a straight answer. And I found that a lot of cancer patients don't have this good fortune, and that the doctors, in some cases, won't tell them exactly where their situation is, whether or not, you know, if they're going to live a long time, or they won't tell them exactly how serious their situation is. And I was fortunate that my doctors always leveled with me.
Dr. Grappi.
I think that initially the physician relates to the patient, and he is not aware of the influences on the patient by family, friends. This is the role that I believe the social worker might be able to assist, that by talking not only with the patient, but also with family members, an open relationship can be established early rather than late, as so often is the case. I think that we tend to wait and call for help from our allied personnel in healthcare, and we should actually involve the social worker, other members of the allied healthcare early in this situation.
Well, Dr. Wiseman, as somebody that deals with this every day, how do you feel?
I think it's important to have emotional support while the person is in the hospital and also in the community. And a pioneer group in our city was started by Mary Spagnola at Mount Sinai Hospital for women that have had a mastectomy. Now that's an in-hospital group. And Mary Spagnola and I had a support group for persons in the community, persons who were living with cancer and who we encouraged in their work life and family life so that they could feel active and functioning members of the community. And we felt that this kind of support from this group of persons who had the same experience and could talk freely was very important in their functioning.
I'd like to know if Mr. Freeman has had to adjust his lifestyle and change his way of living since he's gone through this ordeal, give up any certain things or...
Any vices.
Right, that's the word I'm looking for.
No, I haven't changed my lifestyle at all since I had cancer. I still put in the same amount of working hours as I used to, and I think perhaps I might even put in a few more now because I enjoy it more.
Didn't you change your lifestyle? You said
that's
you got
right.
married in
you
September.
You got married.
Did you forget your wife? She's no, sitting right over here in
Is
case you
advice?
Did.
No.
Mr. Freeman, in regards to your own experience with cancer and the process of the cure, how much importance do you attach to just the will to live?
Talking to the doctors that I had at Roswell, they said that all the surgery and stuff that they did wouldn't have been possible to save me unless I did want, you know, to live very badly. And a lot of the doctors that I've had have given that a lot of credit as far as the reason I lived, although it's not something I really, it's not something I really feel, you know, all the time. I just more or less knew I wasn't going to die. It was just more of an assurance as far as I was concerned.
I've been climbing like King Kong to reach this lady.
Yes, in many forms of cancer, there's more than one way of treating the cancer. What steps would you suggest the cancer patient take to get information and help in determining what form of treatment he would prefer?
Who do you want to direct that to? All three?
Yes.
Okay. Let's start with Dr. Grappi, since he deals with that all the time.
I suppose that those of us in the medical profession who specialize in the treatment of cancer, we probably do things all the same way. What I try to advise patients is to do what they feel comfortable with. If they want another opinion after I have tried to give them everything that is known about their particular disease, and they still feel a little shaky, or the family feels a little shaky, then I encourage them to consult another specialist in cancer care. I think that this is important, not only for the patient, but also for the family, that they are convinced that everything is being done that is possible. The ability to seek consultation is important and should not be lost. Jim had mentioned Roswell because that's where he had had a lot of his care. A lot of the major institutions throughout the country could, you know, provide the same type of thing. It doesn't have to necessarily be one institution. I think that the important thing is to the patient and to the family to feel that we've gotten the best, because that is going to make it easy.
It's interesting to watch Jim's face, because it's obvious to me that he's sold on Roswell. And I guess, you know, if somebody helps you and cures you, you've got to be.
Yes, well, I went to four different hospitals, and I never received the treatment at the other hospitals like I received while I was at Roswell.
Of course, you didn't go to the Cleveland Clinic.
No, I didn't, but Roswell was so thorough, and they'd run so many tests on me, and when I had to go in for my operation, they told me exactly where I stood. And it was just the thoroughness and the efficiency of the place that I really enjoyed. One thing about it, it's a 335-bed hospital, and all they treat is cancer. And so they see cancer every day in many different forms, and they work with it every day, and they've been working hard for like 10 years. And they have like systems set up, and each different kind of cancer would get a certain treatment. But most of the cancers that they do deal with, they go for the aggressive surgery and aggressive chemotherapy or radiation or something like that.
Dr. Wiseman, do you have anything to add to?
No,
not on this particular topic. Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Freeman, you have been expounding a lot of energy and other activities, both during the time that you were battling cancer and now. Can you tell me, please, if you think that getting active for cancer patients is good for them, and why?
In my case, it was. I thought it was very good for me, because being active like that, it takes your mind off of it. It also helps do away with some of the side effects of your chemotherapy. And any time the chemotherapy wasn't so bad that it didn't slow me down, I wouldn't let it. And I think it had helped me a lot as far as getting through those tough years when I did have to take the chemotherapy.
Dr. Wiseman, do you advise your patients to keep busy if they can?
Let's do more than keep busy.
Yeah.
Something meaningful.
Constructive.
Something meaningful, yes. And work does provide structure and meaning to life for a lot of people.
Doctor, would you care to comment?
Anything? Oh, I try to encourage people to also be active, do things.
Mike?
Yes, sure.
I know a lady who worked, and she would go on her lunch hour to get her chemotherapy and then go back to work.
I like that.
I wonder sometimes, after a patient is diagnosed, many times there's a stage of denial. And I'm wondering how to help the family as far as helping the patient, not to deny, or when the denial should stop.
Let's clarify stage of denial first and then answer the question. Because I don't know if everybody knows what that is. And who are you directing it to?
Dr. Wiseman.
Denial. It couldn't be true. You know, it couldn't be me. It couldn't happen. That's denial.
All right. And
yeah. And part of that is necessary to protect the ego. because it is such a blow that it's impossible to take that all in at one time. So for me to be confrontive with people and say, hey, look, you know, you have cancer, you've got to talk about it, it's hard for me, and I don't really believe in being confrontive. I try to take the signal from the other person, and if someone won't talk about it, there's nothing I know to do.
Dr. Grappi.
It's sort of interesting that the patient would like to deny cancer, but they don't deny other diseases. You know, if you tell somebody they have heart disease, they won't deny this, or they won't deny an ulcer, or a gallbladder disease, or kidney disease, but cancer, they frequently do want to deny this.
What do you think about it?
Well, it's a fearful word.
It's true with heart disease, too, I think. That is, people should lose weight and do exercise and so forth. Don't pay attention to that and don't take care of themselves properly. I think it's the fear of death that's connected with cancer and heart disease that mm-hmm. make it just too much to address for some people. But people don't have to fear death anymore with cancer because there are treatments and
right.
there are cures. That's what you're trying to say, right?
Dr. Grappi,
yes.
Do you still, or is it still generally felt that the first attack on cancer is surgery and then followed by either chemotherapy and or radiation?
Well, let's qualify that a little bit. In order to establish the diagnosis of cancer, a biopsy or something must be done, which is a surgical procedure. Now, whether or not the cure, quotes, the approach to cure is surgery or radiation or chemotherapy, all three, one or two, it depends upon the individual case. There's no, I think, no universal approach that should be considered. All three areas, a combined modality approach, are important.
Oftentimes, the cure is worse than the disease, it seems. You talked, Jim, about the violent reactions to chemotherapy. And at one point, you had to ask the doctor, I can't take it anymore.
Well, the chemotherapy that I took was worse than any pain that I ever felt while I had cancer. I would get into vomiting spells for 8 hours, and there was no comparison as far as the pain. It's hard to believe that something that hurts you that bad is really helping you, but it does.
Did you have a question about Laetrile?
I didn't have a question, but I thought in this forum it would be a good idea to maybe discuss feelings about that controversial issue, about that type of therapy.
And we have a couple of minutes left, and maybe everybody could put their 2 cents in. Jim?
As far as Laetrile is concerned, I've heard so much on the subject now that I'm beginning to, you know, I'd like to look at it with an open mind and have a few experiments done on it. However, when I had cancer, somebody had mentioned Laetrile to me, and I mentioned it to my doctors at Roswell. They took me around to 3 hospital beds and showed me people who had cancer and who had come to Roswell 2 years previously and said, what can you do for me? And Roswell said, first we're going to operate. Then we're going to give you chemotherapy, then all your hair is going to fall out, and you're going to feel terrible. And somebody else said, why don't you come down to a sunny beach in Mexico and take Laetrile, and I'll cure you. And 2 years later, these people were in hospital beds at Roswell, and they were dying because they were so far gone that they couldn't save them. And that was the only experience with Laetrile that I've had.
Dr. Wiseman, have you had experiences with Laetrile?
People ask about it, and we've had people who have, you know, submitted to the Laetrile treatment. I think the appealing thing about the whole treatment is that it puts some power back in the person's hands. You know, there's just a terrible feeling of powerlessness, or that you're at someone else's mercy. And the whole program of diet control and rest and whatever else is involved makes the person feel as if he or she is really doing something and has some control. And so I think it has a psychological effect, and some of that is positive. Now, if we could take the good part of that and combine that with other treatments.
I bet Dr. Grappi would defer there.
I think that the public must have confidence in the medical profession, that anything that is of possible help, we will attempt to use in our patients. And our complete rejection of Laetrile is the total absence over 30 years nearly of use, which has not indicated any benefit at all. So that I think that the patient with cancer who is going to turn to anything has got to realize that all is being done that is possible.
You know, we're out of time and we've barely scratched the surface. I want to thank our guests, Jim Freeman. I want to thank you, Dr. Wiseman, Dr. Grappi. And, of course, thank you so much, audience. You've been a great audience. You've been responsive. And thank you at home. Please keep watching. We'll see you again next time. Until then, Mike Keene saying bye-bye for now.
Southgate USA was planned to be a success. That's why you see so many happy people coming out of the stores. Southgate is safe, convenient, comfortable, friendly. 140 stores with something for every member of the family. That's the way it was planned from the start. So people would go home happy and keep coming back. Of course, some people come just to get my autograph. I'll trade you my autograph for that yo-yo.
Forget it. Ted, isn't it?
Another fan.
Peg, help. Remember that permanent I wanted for tonight?
Huh? I don't anymore.
Oh, let me turn my chicken off.
Thanks for dropping everything, Peg.
My chicken.
It's been soaking in Crisco oil an hour.
It must have soaked up more oil. Won't it taste greasy?
Crisco oil hasn't let me down in 15 years. Let's finish it and see.
Good. Doesn't taste greasy.
And it soaked an hour. See? Crisco oil wouldn't let me down.
It's nice to know you can trust Crisco oil to fry chicken that doesn't taste greasy.
The Isley Brothers are challenging you to a showdown. Their tough hit single, Take Me to the Next Phase, lets you know this town ain't big enough for any band but one. The Isley Brothers, showdown. You better be there.
WJKW TV 8 Cleveland.